Well, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
A very warm welcome to you indeed. That quick motion there was just because I wasn't sure if you'd been listening to me last night when I said, you sit down as soon as the Bible's up because you're not standing for the ministers. Yeah. But it seems like every other week that I'm not entirely sure you were actually listening to me. But we'll see how that goes. But a very warm welcome to you. Actually, this evening, I'm going to greet those at home especially, as well as us here in the sanctuary. We've had virtually as many households at home tuning in to watch the service as we've had in the church. And certainly that's increased over the days afterwards with the catch-up TV function of YouTube. So that's been lovely to be able to see some of that. I absolutely love the fact that we're all able to gather to worship together, no matter the time or the place, particularly in one another's company, whatever denomination we might be, that we're able to join together as the children of God, coming together to worship and praise God himself. Well, this evening, it's my pleasure to be able to welcome a colleague, the Reverend Joanne Hood from St. John's Parish, who will be preaching a little bit later and also leading us in the sacrament of communion. Can I just say, in respect of communion later, can you leave your glasses on the wee shelf underneath your pew there? Can you see one just underneath the book stand part of it? Please do just leave your glasses under there. We'll collect them later on. They should be safe enough there out of the way, I hope. I should also mention, while we're talking about St. John's, that tomorrow afternoon there's going to be the Good Friday Vigil at St. John's. It begins at 12 o'clock and runs all the way through to a little after 3 o'clock with a different worship leader every half hour bringing something to us. So you're warmly invited to that, I believe.
Absolutely.
Lovely. This evening, of course, we're going to see some scenes, some further scenes from Jesus' life brought to us by DramaKirk, with excerpts from the Passion Play, Journey Through Easter, written by Simon MacCallum as part of our service. Can I just take the opportunity just to say our thanks to Liz Blackman for leading and directing this. Please do take the opportunity, if you would, to encourage Liz and the rest of the company for their efforts to bring the gospel to life through drama. As many of us know, it can be incredibly easy to get discouraged as we perform our duties of ministry, in whatever form of ministry we serve in, from serving teas to working in the choir, or whatever aspect of how we try to serve the kingdom of Christ. But it's nice to get a little bit of encouragement occasionally as well. Please can we do that? And my thanks also to all those who've been very fruitfully engaged behind the scenes, whether it's with teas or looking after the door, supporting us with our worship and our fellowship, including our organist, Helen Simpson, and choir mistress, and the joint Hamilton Town Centre, not just Town Centre, but Hamilton Town Church choirs as well, for helping to lead us in worship. Thank you so much for that. Now, I should have mentioned last night how we're getting on with the donations to our two charities, our two local charities, the Drop-In Centre and the Jubilee Key Scheme. They're now standing at over £1,000. I think that deserves a wee round of applause, actually. And that's down to your good selves at the door, obviously. The retirement offering will continue throughout the week. It's truly appreciated. Please do keep on giving. It's going to those good causes. I should also probably say that all of the offerings over the course of these evenings are being solely split between these two charities. As in previous years and previous churches, none of those monies are retained for the local church. 100% is going to those charities, 50% to one and 50% to the other, which, as I'm sure you're acutely aware, are wholly supported by volunteers. So 100% of your giving goes to those for whom it's destined to go to. There are no cuts taken for chief executives or churches or anything like that. It all goes to where you want it going to. So I encourage you with that as well. Finally, by way of housekeeping, hopefully by now you know that there's no fire alarm. The toilets are over here in the church and also up in the halls. And you're warmly invited to come up to the halls for a cup of tea after the service concludes as well. So we start our service this evening listening to the joint choirs of the Hamilton churches singing the introit, I give you a new commandment. We're called to worship this evening with words from the Apostle Paul to the young elder Timothy in an age when there was no social security. So notice these words as we find them in 1 Timothy chapter 5. Let the Christian society provide for a widow who is 60 years old. It would be nice if that was still the case with the pension, can I just say, but I'm afraid for those a little bit younger, you'll know you're going to have to work a little bit longer. But those who are well reported of for their good works, such as having been a faithful wife, if she's brought up children, or if she's supported homeless strangers, if she's cared for the sick or poor, if she has washed the feet of fellow Christians, if she has diligently followed every good work. Amen. By faith, whatever gender we find ourselves, we reflect on our own good works, but especially on the one who is the object of our faith, our Jesus. So let's stand if we're able, shall we, and sing our opening item of praise. It's hymn 237, Look Forward in Faith. Let us pray. Lord, on this Maundy Thursday, so named for the mandate that you gave to your followers to love and serve each other, we bring you our praise, all of the praise and honor and glory, as we remember the Last Supper in the upper room. Perhaps we pray as Simon Peter did, please wash not my feet only, but also my hands and my head, but also our hearts, our minds, and our lives. Lord God, you sent your Son into the world, and before his hour had come, he washed his disciples' feet. You had given all things into his hands. He had come from you and was going to you. And what did he do? He knelt down on the floor and washed his friends' feet. He was their teacher and their Lord, yet he washed their feet. Lord God, help us to learn from his example. Help us to do as he has done for us. before we eat the supper, that by faith we recognize as representing your body and your blood. May we reflect on whether we are prepared to wash the feet of all your followers and willingly let you wash our feet. As our loving provider, you gather us as if in an upper room with your Son to be fed by your love and your grace. At that supper, Jesus told us to love one another. And we know that is the heart of his gift, his sacrifice for us. We ask that we might find the source of our own heart, the meaning for our own lives in that Eucharist. Guide us to the fullness of your love and life. The world will know that we are his disciples if we love one another. Strengthen our hands and our wills for love and for service and for a great show of genuine unity in our worship centered on Christ. Keep before us the image of your Son who, being God, became a servant for our sakes, recognizing that whatever the way we see it, in all the different styles of worship and the things that we humanly hold dear, that there is, as we sang last night, but one Lord, one faith, one church, one baptism. All glory be to him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. So we come to you, our Lord, praying together in whatever form of the Lord's Prayer that we're most familiar, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to invite Anne MacLeod now to come up and lead us in our lesson this evening in the Gospel of John.
Good evening. Our reading this evening is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 1 to 17. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus answered, You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand. Peter said to him, You will never wash my feet. Jesus answered, Unless I wash you, you have no share with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, one who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean, and you are clean, though not all of you. For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, not all of you are clean. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Amen. And may God bless to us this reading of his holy word.
Amen. Thank you, Anne. Now, we should be very familiar with the tune of this next hymn by now. It's a long hymn, but each night we've been choosing just a few of the verses. I wonder if we're getting as familiar with the words in the verses. So let's both read and listen as we sing and concentrate on those words, which are, of course, always important. We're going to sing, of course, hymn 399. My song is Love Unknown, and tonight we're singing verses 1, 2, and 6.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When you've been staying somewhere and you know you're about to leave or make your way towards your next destination, perhaps on a holiday, staying in a hotel or some self-catering accommodation or a work trip or even moving house. I wonder what some of those last things are that you spend your time frantically doing, because If you're anything like me, there might be at least some that I could name for you. I'm going to try. I tend to leave packing to the last minute possible. It's not wise, it's not clever, but I've never learnt my lesson, so I still do it. So you'll find me desperately trying to make sure I haven't left anything behind by mistake. Do you go through drawers, perhaps in a hotel room, drawers that you know you didn't put anything into when you first went into, oh, you do it, do you? But perhaps something's jumped in while you weren't looking, so you feel obliged to open them all one by one just to make sure they're empty. Checking the base of the shower for shampoo bottles and shower gel and all the little things I've left behind more than once. Always check everything more than once. Trying to switch off your electric toothbrush that has started buzzing somewhere inside your suitcase without actually opening the suitcase and getting it out to switch it off. That's always a neat trick if you can manage it. And tragically, completely forgetting until it's far too late that you put chocolate in the mini fridge and you'll regret leaving it there for the rest of the day. Checking the weather forecast, maybe, something we do when we're leaving somewhere, in case the place you're heading to is going to need different clothes choices from the place you've woken up in. Checking for tickets, whether it's card, paper tickets, or on your phone. Checking for tickets multiple times if you need them for travel or for events you've signed up for along the way. You know you've got them because you checked 2 minutes ago, but you just wanted to check one more time. Making sure everybody's had that all-important last toilet trip before the journey begins. Collecting up the mini toiletries that haven't been opened yet because you never know when they might become handy. But all you really do is stick them in the cupboard with all the other ones that you've taken from hotel rooms in the past. And why does getting ready to leave always feel frantic? Even if you get up ridiculously early for when you need to check out or check in or board the plane or the train or get a decent run on the motorway before rush hour begins. When that time comes to sort everything for leaving, there's so much to think about. So you do and have and remember all that you need. It's exhausting. When that time comes for Jesus to sort everything for leaving, he doesn't give what he needs a single thought. All he thinks about are the disciples. In the very first verse tonight, Anne read this. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Jesus knew that his hour of departure had come, but he didn't check a single thing to make sure his departure was as he would want it to be. Far from it, in fact, for the cup would not be taken from him. But he instead made his hour of departure all about his own, his disciples, the others that he loved. His hour for his own. He had things he had to ensure were the case, but not for him, for them. The last chance to allow them to carry on, even whilst he knew his destination was the Father via a cross and a sealed tomb. His hour for his own. Because he had to leave. Because he had to show them what love really looked like. Because he had to generate an action that would shape every gathering of disciples from that moment on. His hour for his own. His hour to depart this world because his own would then remain. His hour to provide an example because his own would then repeat it in love for one another. His hour to share a last meal because his own would then have a new tradition. His hour for his own, because even after all they had shared together, they still needed all the help they could get. His hour to pray, and his own would be invited to stay awake with him. His hour to be betrayed and denied, and his own would think it an impossibility. His hour to live with full knowledge, and his own would never join up the dots, at least not for a good few days yet. His hour for his own, then and now. We get to be Christ's disciples today. So how do we fare when Jesus makes his hour of departure all about us? We are to remain and be active in the world. We are to repeat the example of scandalous love seen in that washing of feet. We are to use the new tradition of bread and wine. We are to watch with him. Believe the disappointments we could be. Form the big picture of salvation he was crafting with his very life. Those disciples had a tough time because Jesus knew that his hour of departure had come, but they didn't. Not really. They didn't know what he was doing. But we do. We have the benefit of the whole story, of time. The drawback of distance from it, for sure, but also the benefit of context. We would watch with him, knowing how little time was left. We would believe it possible that we could let him down. We would join up the dots of all the knowledge and insight he had conveyed because we would have known the mysterious and frustrating ways he spoke had all conveyed meaning about his death and resurrection. His hour for his own. So let's take this moment when he knew, coupled with his desire to use it for his own, and build even further on that choice. That is within our power. We have it within our power to be the best kind of disciples we can be, because we understand at least some of what he was trying to convey in this choice of using his hour for his own. We have it within our power to take all the cues, to love as he loved, to hear and learn and be changed. Still flawed, still capable of letting Jesus and each other down, still confused by what the big picture means for us and our daily living. But even with the flaws and the confusion and the troubles, still committed, wholly committed to journey to the end. His hour for his own. And so now, when you're ready, his own should prepare themselves for his hour has come. Amen. Hymn 665, One Bread, One Body.
Thank you. suba la novia, ad archiduci.
We have purchased everything that was needed.
Yeah.
And it was just as you said, Lord. We saw the man carrying the water pitcher and we followed him. And he brought us to this place.
We told him that the master had asked for a room. And it was here, ready for the Passover.
All preparations are made. You've done well.
Is everything well with you, Judas? You look troubled.
I am well. Leave me be.
You've not been yourself these past few days.
I said, leave me be!
Peter! Judas, what's the matter? What are you doing, Master?
You will not wash my feet.
If I do not wash you, Peter, then you shall have no part with me.
Well, Master, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well.
You call me Master and Lord, but if I, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, then you ought to also wash one another's feet. For I have given you the example that you should do for others as I have done for you. The servant is not greater than his master, nor is he that is sent greater than he that sent him. I speak not of you all. I know who I have chosen, so that the scripture may be fulfilled. One of you who breaks bread with me has lifted up his heel against me.
What? I don't believe it. He that eats with you.
One of you who eats with me shall betray me.
No, that can't be true.
Who would betray you?
We're your friends.
One of you shall betray me.
Why are you looking at me? Is it I?
Is it me? No, can't be.
Master, who is it?
He it is to whom I give the morsel when I've dipped it. Judas. What you have to do, do it quickly.
Where is he going, Master?
Will I go after him?
No. He's doing an errand for me.
Maybe he's just buying himself.
Brothers, sit down with me. And now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him.
Lord, thank you for sending your Son to be our teacher, our friend, and our Saviour.
Take this and eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Take this and drink. This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, which is poured out for you. I have greatly desired to eat this Passover meal with you, my brothers, before I suffer. I tell you, I will not drink from the fruit of the vine again until I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. There is no greater love for a man than to lay down his life for his friends. I cannot be with you much longer, my friends. You can't go where I'm going.
Where do you go, Master?
Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?
Where I'm going, you cannot follow me now, Thomas, but you will follow me after.
Why can't I follow you now? I would lay down my life for you.
Would you lay down your life for my sake, Peter?
Yes, Lord. Even if all of these fall away from you, I never will.
I have prayed for you, Peter, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers.
I would go to prison for you. I would die.
I tell you that this very night, before the rooster crows, you will have denied me 3 times.
That's not true. I would die for you. I would never deny you.
Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not true, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And now, I give you all a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. You believe in me. You know that I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father but through me. I came forth from the Father, and I'm come into the world. Again, I shall leave the world and return to the Father.
What does he mean?
The hour comes. You will each be scattered, every man to his own, and you will leave me alone. But I will not be alone, because the Father is with me. I tell you these things, that you might have peace. In this world, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world.
Scalerico de oro, de oro y de marfil. Para que suba la novia a dar kiddushin.
This is the table to which the disciples of Jesus are invited. Let us give thanks for all that is here for us. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks for this invitation. Knowing Jesus loved his own until the end, we, as Christ's disciples today, just as flawed, confused, troubled, humbly accept the invitation to meet him here. We give thanks for the sacrifice of your Son and for our opportunity to respond in faith. Send your Holy Spirit to settle upon us and this bread and wine that as we share in the body and blood of Christ, we may find sustenance for all that lies ahead. Amen. Among friends gathered round a table, Jesus took bread and broke it. Take, eat, my body broken for you. Then he took the cup. This is the new covenant with God, made possible because of my death. Drink from it, all of you, to remember me. These are the things of God for the people of God. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Having shared around the table, the disciples sang a hymn. Omitting verse 4, we sing hymn 396, "And Can It Be?"
Oh,
you leave here tonight, having received sustenance for the journey, think of Jesus. Think of everything that happened to him on Thursday night. And rest well, for tomorrow requires all the strength we can muster. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you and all those whom you love and all those you should love this night and forevermore.